the BTN, as well as into policies related to scholarships, educational and training privileges, permits and licenses for the opening of trade and business, land and housing, the corporate equity market, etc., etc. Its tentacles extend into practically every sphere of life, economic, social, administrative, even cultural and religious. Now, racism in Malaysia has not, in the last 50 years, remained idle or stagnant, but it has developed into a subtle, sometimes crude, pervasive and increasingly aggressive form, especially in its institutionalized manifestation. Now, as the organizers of this forum have noted, the political, legal and administrative structures of our country, the anchors and props of this institutionalization may need to be fundamentally revamped. For this to happen, the public view of what is truly happening must become sharper. This is not an easy task, given the resources at hand and the determination of the supporters and beneficiaries of racism in Malaysia to muzzle any effort, any attempt at opening up public discourse and opening up discussion on this subject. Therefore, I must congratulate Hindraf and the Civil Rights Committee of the KL and Selangor Chinese Assembly Hall for taking up this effort to consult with the public, with distinguished speakers, and to address this, what is still regarded by many as a taboo, an ultra-sensitive topic in the public sphere. According to them, this is the first of a series of fora to highlight and educate about the structures and processes that entrench racism in our system, the impact to the nation, to us, to our children, and to the future of this country if it's left unchecked. Now, I would like to introduce very quickly the three speakers for tonight, and I'm going to go over their CVs very quickly. Dr. Hua Kia Soon on my left is well known to all of you. He's a director of Suaram, received his bachelor's BA economics as well as PhD in sociology from Manchester University. He's taught at the University of Singapore in sociology. He's better known, not for his lecturing days, but he was arrested under the ISA during Operation Lala in 1987 and was detained for 445 days without trial. Now, upon his release in 1989, he helped to found Soaram, the leading human rights organization in Malaysia. I think I'll stop at that. He's got a longer CV. Now, our second welcome. Selamat datang. I was going to introduce you in your absence. Mr. Ganesan, trained as an engineer, half his career has been spent working in industry, the other half as a corporate consultant. From the year 2007, 5 years ago, he awakened from what he says was his slumber. He was awakened by the Hindraf rally and has become active in human rights work with Hindraf. He's secular in his political beliefs and he thinks that the country has significant opportunity for change. Our third speaker is going to be Dr. Azmi Sharom. He did not respond to my emails for his CV, so I went into Wikipedia and Google, and this is what I got. He's associate professor at the Faculty of Law, University of Malaya. His LLB honors is from University of Sheffield. His LLM is from Nottingham, and his PhD is from Suez. So a thoroughly British educational background. Now, his area of expertise is in conflict of law and Malaysian and international environment law. And of course, he's better known amongst you, most of you here, for his column, to those of you who read the staff. Brave New World, which is a very highly regarded column, and he's also got a website. And I've noticed that since 2008, his annual output in the Star has declined from 51 articles in 2008 to 20-something in 2009. There's something wrong in the tabulation in your web page.
Yes.
All right, now to business then. We're going to have the three speakers all in a row, okay? So be patient with your questions and comments. I think we'll have a more fruitful and interactive discussion. Unless you have something really burning that you want to ask the speaker that you can't wait, you know. I'm going to try to get the speakers say their piece, and then we'll have a discussion. Is that all right with you? Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Lin. Good evening to all of you. Obviously, this topic arouses a lot of interest in the country. As I begin my presentation, let me make a few beginning remarks. What triggered this forum this evening, basically, was this paper that Mr. Vedam Murthy, the chairperson of Hindraf, presented at the U.S. House of Representatives Foreign Affairs Committee. It was a briefing, and it was a briefing to the staff of the congressman, the intent being at the next stage to request a hearing in the House of Representatives, basically to lay out to the world what is happening in the country below the surface. Okay? So I will be hitting on some of the highlights from the paper, and I recommend that you all take some time and read. I know there's a lot of good details there. Secondly, there are some remarks I'll be making, some statements in my presentation, which can be misconstrued. I want to say at the outset, okay, I have to say it in the ways that reflect reality. I am not anti-Malay. I am not anti-Islam. I am for the people of this country, all the peoples of this country. And I'm against racism. I'm against institutionalized racism. I'm against racist policies, the system, and the perpetrators of the system. But pardon me if, you know, in some of the slides, it may come across, because I'd like to say it as it is. Okay. It is my belief, as, you know, and this is some, you know, a discussion we've been having, my belief. Even before that, as I came in, there were several members who asked me, do you really think we can do it to eliminate institutionalized racism in this country? My answer to that was this. Racism is morally wrong. And it has to be eliminated. It has to be eradicated. Slavery was wrong. Colonialism was wrong. Apartheid was morally wrong. They all went. Racism is morally wrong. It has to go. But It is not going to go by itself. It will go, in my opinion, this is my personal opinion, it will go that when we as intellectuals stand up and contribute to changing social values in the country, among the community. At one time, if we had slavery, it was because it was socialization. It was okay. What's wrong with it? After all, they are savages. They're not human beings. That was the social value. But today, that social value has changed significantly. And what do we say? How do we all view slavery? Not that slavery has gone completely away. The pernicious aspects have gone, but it's gone undercover, and it has lost social sanction. So my answer to the question is, yes, racism must go, racism will go, but it's not going to go on its own, it's going to go through effort like this and more, where we educate the people, and once people are educated, social values change, politicians just follow. The laws then take care of themselves. Okay? So this is Hindraf's contribution to progressing the social values. Okay, I'm going to lay out first the case of institutionalized racism in the country. You know, much of what I speak about is, you know, daily occurrence for many of us, so it won't be exactly all new, but I'm going to lay out the case. And then I'm going to talk about some of the initiatives that, you know, we Hindraf, with the limited resource, you know, of the core activists that we have, that we live up to. And then talk a little bit about, okay, where do we go from here? Okay, first, as what Dr. Lim said just now, the kind of racism that we have in our country is subtle, because anybody who comes into this country sees all the goodness around will not agree with you if you say, you know, there is a racist regime behind all this. It's subtle. It's pervasive. We know that. It pervades all aspects of our lives. We know that. And it's increasingly encroaching, aggressive. And as competition, as contention within the economy increases, we expect that it will get even more aggressive if left unchecked.